I would like to thank AIOS and Fairuz for giving me this opportunity to talk on a subject which is a little less discussed, canalicular obstructions. Let's get straight. These are my financial disclosures. I would recommend this particular major review in current eye research, where we actually described and discussed various modalities of canalicular reconstructions and recanalization. So for canalicular obstruction, we need to just answer five questions, and we'll answer them one after another. Five important questions, right? The first question, how common are they? So if you look at this major epidemiological review that we published, which has more than 20,000 cases of lacrimal drainage disorders, you see that the bicanalicular obstructions were the commonest among, I'm just restricting myself only to canalicular obstructions. The bicanalicular were common, followed by isolated lower canalicular, then common canalicular, then canaliculostenosis, followed by isolated upper canalicular obstructions. And you see it ranges, all of them range somewhere less than 1% overall. So they're not so very common also. The second question to answer is, what are the causes of them? There you see it's all listed, causes of canalicular obstructions. But what I have not mentioned here is a bulk of them which fall under the idiopathic category, where it's not that there's no reason, it's just that we are still unaware of those reasons for canalicular obstructions. The third question, and I think it's a very important question, is how would you diagnose it? And how would you differentiate a canalicular stenosis from a canalicular obstructions? There are a host, in a lot of ways in which you can do, and I think the simplest one is a good clinical examination with specific probes. You can use Clark 30 probes or Bowman 40 probes, or even better if you can have it, or it's not expensive, but if you can have it, the Miyake probes, which are specifically designed to differentiate between a canalicular stenosis and an obstruction. And then obviously there are Dacryo endoscopies and imaging modalities. These are specifically useful, more so the imaging modalities, if you are planning to intervene using, say, angioplasty catheters, if you want to treat the canalicular stenosis or obstructions, then those becomes more pertinent. These are examples of canalicular stenosis. If you see the picture on the right, I'm just showing a sequence of those images where how it gets narrowed down as we progress. You see from the first to the third picture, you see how it's getting narrower and narrower, and almost it's almost occluded in the third picture. But these are all still stenosis as compared to look at the obstructions, right? Obstructions don't narrow down that way, so you still have the rim within the canalicular lumen that you see. You can see a rim of nice circumferential constriction, and then as you go near, you can see that how completely it is actually blocked, and that's a dead end. So you can, if I take you back again, look at this. It's very easy to differentiate canalicular stenosis, and look at this, obstructions. Now there are other modalities with which you can use it, and these are being increasingly used specifically because, you know, these are all like doing an angioplasty. So whenever you are using those kind of modalities, these are very useful intraoperatively and immediately post-op also. So this is an example that you see of the left side, where you see an isolated lower canalicular obstruction, and there you can see a lot of dye spilling in the left side. As compared to the right side, you can see right till the nasolacrimal duct, it's quite healthy. Then dacryoscintigraphy. I won't go into those details of all the characteristics for the want of time. I just want to give you an overview of the canalicular obstructions. There you see dacryoscintigraphies. This is an example. If you look on the picture on the right, there you see the left side common canalicular obstruction is very evident. CT-DCGs or MR-DCGs can be utilized to identify the exact location of that one. The picture on the left shows a common canalicular obstruction, and on the right also shows common canalicular obstruction with a lot of spillage of dye into the conjunctival fornix. Now, the fourth question to answer, and which is important because there is a lot of confusion about what is proximal, what is mid, and what is distal. And if you look at the literature, there was a lot of confusion. So what we decided was to simplify this one based on two parameters, one on the newer anatomy of the canaliculus that we have published, and second based on the outcomes of it. And the third reason, if you look at from the management aspect, is how commonly is a location at a given point has other associated obstructions or stenosis. Like at what point in the canaliculi, if I find a stenosis or an obstruction, will I likely find a similar one in other parts of the lacrimal drainage? So based on these three parameters, we have simply divided it as proximal up to three to six is distal. And anything beyond six is distal, because unlike the previous classifications, which talk about beyond eight, that's not true based on the newer anatomy that we know. So beyond anything beyond six should be considered as distal. Now, the fifth question to answer is, how do we manage? I won't go into, again, the details of the surgical techniques and the complications and how do you manage each one of them. But just to give you an overview, canalicular trephination, both better endoscopy guided or not guided, is one of the commonest modalities of management. And the Sisler's trephine that you see is quite commonly used. And it is very specifically designed for the canaliculi. And if you look at how you assess the canalicular obstructions, how you prime the trephine, and how you go about it, and how you maintain the course. So the anatomical course is something which is very important in trephination, and that needs a good amount of training. You know, I would put the training for canalicular trephination, the learning curve is much steeper than what one would expect from an endoscopic DCR also. So because of the complications and possibility of very easy false passage without the surgeon realizing it. So I won't go into those details. Those are all published, and all these images that you see are from the Atlas. So you can go back and read those details of it. And this is just to give you an example of the scar cylinder and how you can actually sculpt the canalicular obstructions from within the lumen, and you can have very decent kind of results. These are examples of the scar cylinders within the lumen of the trephines. Well, for a good chunk of cases, I also believe in doing an endoscopic guided trephination, where here I've opened up the lacrimal sac and under guidance, I'm getting the trephine here. And this is also something which we have published, and you can read the details of the indications and when we do those kind of things. There are a lot of advantages, and one of those examples, the photograph that you see, how beautifully that canalicular scar is sculpted, if you can see that image of it. So there are a lot of advantages of doing this, and I won't go into these complications for the sake of time. The upcoming modality is balloon canaliculoplasty, more so for canalicular stenosis. And I'm finding increasingly with the use of angioplasty catheters now, the results are appearing better. What previously we used to do was to use the regular 2 millimeter and 3 millimeters, and 2 and 3 millimeters were designed way back in, a decade ago. And it is not sacrosanct that why should we use 2 millimeter? There's no justification why somebody uses 2 millimeter or 3 millimeter. So the coronary balloons give a wide range from 0.5 to almost like 10 millimeter in diameter. So, there's a lot of room for maneuvering. So this is just an example of how we can do a balloon canaliculoplasty. This is using a 1 millimeter coronary angioplasty catheter. I won't go into the details. It's all published. You can read that. I have found that this modality is really helpful in those chemotherapy-induced canalicular stenosis. This is an example of Pemetrex. Just look at the picture A and D. Look at the difference in the punctum and canaliculus that we have made. If you look at picture B and E, look at the canalicular stenosis by decorative endoscopy, and look at the difference of following balloon dilatation. So it's quite dramatic. The last modality of management is CDCR. I won't go into those details. It's quite well-established modality, and we have a host of papers on that. You can read the indications and how to manage that, and including the quality of life. So in conclusion, I would say that For lacrimal surgeons, the most important challenge is to differentiate accurately between a stenosis versus an obstruction. And balloon canaliculoplasty is coming up as a very nice modality to manage it in a little less invasive way. And today we have workable solutions for canalicular obstructions.